Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Rockledge Presbyterian Church. We are the welcoming church on the river and happy to be together today, especially all of you here with us in the sanctuary and those of you who are joining us via Facebook and YouTube. Glad to be together. For those of you who are joining us from home, please secure your elements of bread and wine so that you may participate with us in communion a little bit later in the worship service. There are some announcements I would highlight for you in our bulletin. Notice that the next men's group breakfast will be this next Saturday at 9 a.m. in Calvin Hall. If you plan to attend, please let Alan Foster, right there waving his hand, please let Alan or call the church know or call the church office and let us know so that we have enough food for you for the breakfast. Also, you see an announcement about the per capita, which is our connection fee that we participate in with the General Assembly, our denomination. If you would like to contribute toward that, you are welcome to do so, and the instructions are in your information bulletin. Also, next Saturday, Saturday's a busy day, we have a brass concert that will be here in the sanctuary, free to all of you and to the public. If there are a musician lover friends of yours that you think would especially enjoy the concert, please encourage them to attend. All that will happen as far as donations is that there will be a basket for donations for the brass band. And so you can contribute to that if you would like. It is not a requirement.
Man, director says that it's good, y'all come.
Oh. For those of you who could not hear, the band director says it's really good and you will enjoy it. There are prayer requests that are listed in your bulletin. In addition to that, Dan and Shirley, in our early service, their granddaughter's husband died suddenly, and so they request prayers for their granddaughter, Kristen, and her family as they deal with this very unexpected loss. And so prayers for them, in addition to all of those that are listed in our bulletin. We are celebrating some birthdays this week. Just a couple of days ago, we celebrated Winnie's birthday, and Shirley's birthday is coming up in a couple of days. Haley, her birthday, are you in the up in the balcony? Haley has a birthday coming up, and so we celebrate with her. When you see her following the worship service, be sure and tell her, gosh, I'm so glad you were born. So, Haley, happy birthday to you coming up. And Caroline celebrates a birthday. I'm not aware of any other announcements this morning, so let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you.
Good morning. Please rise as you are able and join me in the call to worship. Listen for the word of the Lord. Enter into God's house with praise.
Our temple is the body of Christ.
Let us worship God. Our opening hymn is number 35, Praise Ye the Lord the Almighty. Knowing that nothing can separate us from God's love in Jesus, let us choose to be honest with God and one another by confessing our individual and corporate sins. Let us pray. Holy God, you gave commandments to your chosen people so they would know how to live. We would rather argue about them than live by them. Some of us have made idols of them. Some of us consider them quaint and irrelevant. O God, in your mercy, forgive us. Remind us that even your foolishness is wiser than we can imagine. Remind us that your commandments are, as the psalmist says, sweeter than honey. Write your law on our hearts, that we might live for you. Hear our confession as we pray silently.
Amen. Friends, hear the sound of love poured out for you and for me. This is the cleansing water of baptism, God's grace for you and for me our whole lives long. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. Sisters and brothers, in the name of Christ, I declare that your story is known, your sin is forgiven, and your life is made new. In the name of Jesus Christ, We are forgiven. Thanks be to God. In response to God's wonderful and amazing grace, we sing praise. And so let us sing our praise to God. You may be seated.
In order to help us read and interpret the scripture, we are in need of the Spirit's help. Let us pray together the prayer for illumination that is printed in your bulletin. God of all truth, put a new and right spirit within us, so that as we hear your word read and proclaimed, we may hear your voice and respond with courage. Amen. Our Old Testament reading today is Exodus 20, 1 through 17. Listen for the word of the Lord. Then God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that your Lord, the Lord your God, is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox, or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor."
Jesus stood the brood.
Our New Testament reading today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 2, verses 13 through 22. In the other Gospels, this particular event that we're about to read from the Gospel of John, in the other Gospels, it comes at the end of Jesus' ministry and is the very thing that incites violence against Jesus. In John's Gospel, however, it is in the beginning of his ministry. John chapter 2, beginning with verse 13. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord, it stands forever. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Are there children who would like to come forward for a children's moment, please? Okay, anything that I ask that you don't know the answer to, I'm going to look back here, and these folks are going to help us, okay? Does that sound all right? Okay. All right, can anybody tell me what church season we're in that's represented by the color purple? It begins with a L sound. Lent. Okay, Lent is the church season that's approximately 40 days, not including Sundays, 40 days before the big church season that we celebrate in the courtyard and in the sanctuary called Easter. Very good. You knew that. And so we're celebrating or we're yes, we're celebrating and recognizing the season of Lent in which we are remembering all of the sadness and hardship that Jesus had before Easter. And some of us would say that you can't really celebrate Easter well if you don't also go through the journey of Lent, of recognizing the challenges that Jesus had, of recognizing the sadness and the pain that Jesus felt. And so we take these days to say we're sorry to God, to Jesus, and to ask for Jesus to help us understand exactly how much he loves us. Now, there's something in the Old Testament passage that Miss Karen read for us today. It's 10 rules. Can you tell me what they're called in the Bible? 10 rules. They're called? Commandments. Okay. And those rules are the underlying focus of everything that Jesus does and says in, when he is here. Jesus was Jewish, and so he followed those rules as well. Now, he had a different interpretation sometimes to those rules when he said that you're when the rule said you're supposed to keep the Sabbath, which means you're supposed to worship God and keep the Sabbath, keep Sundays sacred. That didn't mean that you couldn't also eat and pick some corn on the way. So he would reinterpret those rules. Let's say a prayer together. Dear Jesus, thank you for loving us. Thank you for always being with us. We're so glad you came to show us how to live. We love you, Jesus. Amen. You may take the light with you to Children's Church. Fortunately, there's candles everywhere, so or lighters everywhere, so we'll be okay. Friends, we began our Lenten journey on Ash Wednesday just a couple of weeks ago with the sign of the cross marked in ashes on your forehead, reminding us of our mortality and that while we're here, Jesus has declared us to be the salt of the earth and the light of the world. Just a couple of weeks ago, we started our Lenten journey with that. In the first Sunday of Lent, we learned of Jesus' baptism, in which God declared Jesus and, by extension, us to be God's child and wondrously loved forever and ever. We watched as Jesus began his ministry, knowing his identity in God and how it helped him to face the temptations that he faced in the wilderness. And last Sunday, we learned that God's power through Jesus will look different than our cultural understanding of power. Instead of our cultural understanding of power, Jesus tells his disciples that his kind of power means suffering love and self-denial. Lent's cross lessons have been challenging for us to hear. And today's lesson, I'm afraid, is not any less challenging. So standing in the prophetic tradition of speaking truth to power, Jesus enters the religious institution of the day, the temple, with a whip and an attitude. Like the prophets of old who chastised the people for their lax worship and their exploitation of the poor, Jesus does the same in today's passage. You may want a little bit of context for our passage today. The Jewish people were in the midst of their annual pilgrimage to the temple to pay their head tax. And the finance committee was in the courtyard making sure everything came out right. And I don't mean any disparaging comments to our finance committee, mind you. So they were probably in the courtyard making sure everything came out right and probably unscrupulously keeping a percentage of the profit for themselves. In those days, a sacrificial system was still in force, and several different kinds of animals were on hand for the pilgrims to choose from based upon their family's wealth and status. The animals ranged in sizes from large, unblemished cattle to smaller, unblemished sheep to even smaller, unblemished doves. They had to buy them in Jerusalem because who wants to travel with doves and with sheep and cattle? It'd be kind of hard for the long distance they had to travel. They had to buy them in Jerusalem when they arrived. So there were the animals to purchase, and just like we do when we enter a foreign country, the travelers also needed the right kind of money to purchase the animals in Jerusalem, in the temple. Money changers were available in the temple courtyard to change the Roman coins that people carried for their basic livelihood into the proper temple coins for the tax and sacrificial animal. It was just a bonus for the religious authorities that it happened to be the opportune time also for a major capital improvement fundraising project. And the people were obligated to participate. The temple had been under construction for many years, we read, by the time Jesus walked into it on this visit. So capital improvement project right there, and people have to come to pay their head tax, and they have to sacrifice an animal. Perfect. We don't really know exactly why Jesus was angry. We can easily speculate on a couple of things. One thing, we know the marketplace chaos was inside the Gentile part of the temple, inside their place for worship. So there was certainly nothing related to worship going on in that space. Too many feathers flying. The temple was set aside as a place for worship, not buying and selling. It'd be kind of like setting up shops in different corners here in our sanctuary so that you could buy your way to worship, so that you could, you know, consequently earn God's love and favor. In John's gospel, this event happens at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, right after the other sign of God's glory, where he turned the water into wine. Right after that is when we see Jesus coming to Jerusalem. Remember that John's gospel is all about the signs rather than miracles that Jesus performs to point to his identity as God's son and one who stands in line with the prophets of Israel's past. Like the prophets of old, Jesus demonstrates his concern for the worship of the people, its purpose, and its practice. When I have performed wedding or funeral ceremonies over the years in different places where I've served, I've occasionally gotten some strange requests related to the sanctuary. One person in Dothan wanted the church season banners, these kinds of things, and we had really tall ones as well, wanted the church season banners removed and team sports banners put in their place. Others have simply wanted to remove some of the religious symbols in the sanctuary. You know, those crosses can be a little distasteful. Each time these kinds of requests are made, I have a little education to do about how the sanctuary is used for worship and worship of God alone. And nothing is to be in the sanctuary that does not point to God, is not used for worship, because that's what we're here to do. We're here to worship God and God alone. This includes weddings and funerals. The social hall, we call it Calvin Hall here, is different. It's a fellowship space. So's the narthex. We might occasionally offer a worship service in the social hall, and when we do, our worship team works hard to set the space up so that it looks and feels like a worship space. We might light candles to remind us that the space is sacred and holy, invoking God's presence. We remove anything that distracts from centering on our relationship to God. Worship spaces are supposed to point to God, point to our Creator. They often inspire awe and wonder, and also inspire connection with those who worship with us. In a social hall or narthex, however, we don't mind selling Girl Scout cookies or camp cards, doing things for the Boy Scouts, or maybe selling tickets to a particular event or taking food donations. We don't mind that in the narthex and in the social hall. The sanctuary space is different. So perhaps one reason Jesus was angry was that the worship space had been turned into a chaotic marketplace. That's one idea for why Jesus was angry. Another reason Jesus could have been outraged was the way the poor were being exploited in favor of the upkeep of the institution. In the line of prophets who chastised the nation for ignoring the plight of the poor and the disadvantaged, Jesus calls the money changers robbers, or a den of thieves in the other gospel accounts, just like the tax collectors often overcharged so that they could pocket some money. These money changers were likely doing the same thing, all, and this is the kicker, all in the name of God. It seems the church, the temple, itself had become a powerful enterprise existing primarily to take care of itself. And because in those days the temple represented the place where God resided, it held great power over the people, and they were obligated to do what was prescribed for them, to be found in favor by God and by the religious authorities of the day. Well, that was top priority. So Jesus might have been upset about how the religious practices of the day were really more deceptive, not worshipful, maybe even exploitive, and way too similar to the marketplace strategies in the Roman culture around them. So lest we get into the habit of thinking, well, that was then and this is now, that doesn't apply to us, lest we think we are immune to such practices, I invite you to remember a little of our history. In the 16th century, the church, the big C church, sold indulgences to the people so that they could purchase eternal life for their loved ones who had died. It was the last straw for the reformer Martin Luther, who felt the church had become equated with the powers and principalities of the culture around it and existed mainly to support itself while it exploited the poor. Oh, and let's just bring it a little closer to home. It's not been all that long ago that we in the Presbyterian Church sold pews to families in our worship space. How many poor families
were turned away because their pride would not allow them to worship with us if they were unable to afford a pew. H. Glauer puts it this way: entering the temple, Jesus discovered how deceiving appearances can be. While the space appeared to fulfill its function, closer inspection revealed that it had forgotten its purpose. The trappings were still in place, but the place had no heart for its reason for existence. It had been taken over by buyers and sellers, consumers and marketers who knew how to fill the pews and meet the capital campaign goals. The ways of the world, he says, invade the church gradually, subtly, never intentionally, always, though supposedly in service of the church and its mission. But the ways of the world are the ways of the world. Soon the church is full of cattle and sheep and turtle doves and money changers. It's a word of caution for us as we are tempted at times to put ourselves and our church at the service of powers that are decidedly less than who God is. Anytime we worry more about paying the pastor's salary or renovating the parlor more than we do about mission and worship, well, we'd better watch out for Jesus and his whip. So, what are the danger zones for us as a congregation? Danger zones in which we care more about maintaining the institution than we do about worship and service. In what ways do we attempt to sell God's grace? In the past, in this place, as in many places, it's been when we expected everyone to look and act just like us. And we were unwelcoming to those who were different. But how about today? What is the challenge for us today? Where would Jesus clean house today? This passage in John is a challenging one. Sometimes it's difficult to see when we as a church are the money changers in this passage and simply accommodating to the culture around us rather than doing what Jesus asks us to do. And you know what Jesus asks us to do, which is to transform the culture around us rather than being transformed ourselves into the culture. The culture is dying to hear that Jesus frees us from being self-centered to being God and other-centered. And in order to do that, the church must look and act different. I have a favorite story that I think illustrates this the best, and it's from one of my favorite authors. His name is Will Campbell. He has died several years ago. He was a Southern Baptist pastor, preacher, as he put it, and he writes of his story, his autobiography, in a book called Brother to a Dragonfly. And it's mainly about him and his relationship to his brother, but he also talks about his best friend, P.D. East, in the story. And he said P.D. East was fond of saying, "So, hey, Will, how's the Easter chicken church these days? And Will just let it go until finally he said it enough that he said, "Okay, I'll bite. What do you mean, the Easter chicken church?" And that was exactly what P.D. wanted. He wanted to tell him about it, which is, you know, the church is kind of like this Easter chick that myself and my wife bought our daughter 1 year for Easter. And that little chick was just glorious and cute and fun until my daughter didn't like care much about it anymore. And so it kind of outlasted its usefulness, and we took it to a chicken yard to our friends. And they put it in the chicken yard, and that poor little chick just suffered because the other chickens would peck the heck out of it and wouldn't let it get the food. It was just awful. That poor little chick suffered. And one day, that little chick started sprouting feathers, and it became a Rhode Island Red. Wonder of wonders. And it wasn't long until that chicken began slowly pecking the other chickens in the yard, keeping them from the food, and becoming just like the other chickens. So how's the fate of the Easter Chicken Church, Will? The church is supposed to look different and act different. The cross lessons for the third Sunday in Lent is that we, as God's people, are here for a purpose. We're here to worship God, and we're here to serve others. Standing in line with the prophets of old, it means that when we see God's purpose being thwarted, it's okay to get angry and make a change. And when we become complacent and become so well adjusted to the culture around us, God may just remind us that we better watch out for the whip. Amen.
Please rise as you are able and join me as we affirm our faith. Let us confess the faith of our baptism. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Our communion hymn is hymn number 510. We are singing verses 1 and 2 only at this time. Thank you.
may be seated. On the night in which Jesus was arrested, he was having dinner with his friends, with his disciples. And after giving thanks for the bread, he took it and he broke it. And I'm sure he said something that was strange to his disciples because he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, after supper, he poured the cup. He said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood, shed for the forgiveness of your sins." Friends, this is not a Presbyterian table. It is the Lord's table, and you are all invited to this table to taste and see that the Lord is indeed good. God calls us from east and from west, from north and from south, those who have gone before us, those who are coming after us, those who are at home. God calls us all together to taste and see that the Lord is good and that the Lord loves us and expects something from us. We are reminded at this table that there is light, that love will win over all darkness, over all death, over all fear. This table is a reminder as we are walking through our Lenten and life journeys together. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Let us pray. Eternal God, it is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise. You created us and we are yours. You created the world and it is yours. You sent Jesus to show us how to live, and it is in him that we understand more fully who you are and what you want from us. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we broke and the cup we blessed, both here and in the homes of those watching, may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ and with all who are baptized in his name, that we may be one in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Communion will be done by intinction today, and you will come forward by the center aisle and receive your bread on whichever side you come from and consume it, and you will receive a cup. And consume that and place your cups in the baskets on the side before returning to your seat by the side aisle. Those of you who are unable to come forward, I make sure I see you and I will serve you where you sit. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Won't you come? Has everyone been fed? Has everyone in this broken and beautiful world that God made, has everyone been fed with the knowledge of the love and grace of our Lord Jesus Christ? I think not. There is work to be done, and for that we will need prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, as you fed your Exodus people in the wilderness with unexpected food, so you feed us at this table with a simple loaf and cup. Here you transform us by the working of your wondrous love to be Christ's body in the world. Send us from this place out into your broken and beautiful world to bear your good news of hope and joy for all. This we pray in your holy name. Amen. Please rise as you are able and let us sing verse 2 again and then verse 3. Friends, let us be generous in the giving of our lives and our offerings. For those of you who wish to contribute online, you may safely do so through our website's online giving button. Let us give.
Thank you.
Holy God, all that we have and all that we are already belongs to you. Please use these gifts, your tithes, to accomplish your will and purpose in this place at this time. This we pray in your holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Remembering our prayer requests that were mentioned earlier, let us pray. Gracious God, whose power is made perfect in weakness, whose wisdom appears as foolishness in this world, we thank you for what the Apostle Paul calls the seeming weakness and foolishness of the cross. In Jesus, you overturn all our usual ways of behaving and believing. You scatter our false notions of discipleship as easily as coins that are spilled from a box. You correct our notions of piety and order with fierce passion. Forgive, we pray, where we have failed you. Do not let your church become content or be self-contained as an institution. We ask you to cleanse what is distorted in us and raise us to new life so that we may be the body of Christ, your temple, in and for the world. We confess that it is with a bit of fear and joy that we ask this in Christ's name. Today, there are many in our midst who are not worried about such things because they're just trying to make it through the day. We pray for those who are battling illness, depression, addiction, and grief. We lift to you our friend Betty Jean, who just left, who is suffering from concern for her son and grandchild. And we pray for Dan and Shirley, for their granddaughter Kristen and her family as they deal with a sudden loss. We pray your presence, mercy, and comfort for each one. We lift to you those who are mentioned in our bulletin, knowing that you know their needs even better than we do. We ask for your presence, your care for each one. And we pray for this church that your will be accomplished and that those of us who might stand in the way, like myself or anyone else, that you will show us the right way. Thank you for always being with us, always calling us forward, and never giving up on us. This we pray as we remember the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please rise as you are able, and let us sing our sending hymn, hymn number 826.
Thank you.
Friends, go in peace to love and serve the Lord, and as you go, may you know the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the energy of the Holy Spirit. Amen.